time and we'll just start talking. I've got everything running.
Good morning. Twice a week, or twice a summer, or twice a year we get this kind of weather. Is that what it is?
Rachel, stand down.
So nice. And nice to have you here. It's a good break in a week, isn't it? To come and see your friendly, smiling, very nice faces, right? I want to read something to you about Joe Frazier. When Joe was training for his heavyweight fight with Muhammad Ali, he got up and ran 5 miles at 4:30 every morning. Joe said that many times after he ran 4.5 miles, he could hear a little voice from inside saying, "Why don't you quit? No one's looking. No one will know." Joe said he just kept running as he thought to himself, "Brother, I'm the last person I want to quit." What's that good message? Probably nothing. But I thought it was good. And I'll give you time to digest that. I do have my son here, and daughter-in-law, Rebecca and Dan, and the children. And we should have them here. Appreciate them coming. There we go. I want to speak on what I have titled two great reaction challenges, all right? Reaction challenges. Two areas in our life that might defeat us. And we need to be well aware of this. I've titled them two great reaction challenges that we will all face. And how we handle these go a long ways to determine the quality of the life we're going to have. The first one I spoke on about, maybe 3 months ago, and that's when life throws occur. Down here Thursday, some of you people at the multiple, is it right? Cafe, delightful place, and somebody from another church. For those of you listening on the radio, it's a good place for Christians to gather as well as the unsaved. And I was talking to one of the ladies there, and she mentioned that while I was speaking on that message, her situation, they were throwing her. Automatically thrown curves. They're pretty obvious. When something major hits us, it's pretty obvious. And I just want to give you a quick reminder of what we must do. When thrown a curve, first thing we need to do is recognize that we all face tribulation. Jesus said, and in Job 5:7 it says, "Man is born to trouble, as surely as sparks fly upward." And then Jesus says in John 16:33, "In this world you're going to have tribulation." I'm not picking on you when you go through a hard time. That's life as it is here on earth. So when we're throwing that curve, first of all, recognize, happens to all of us, this is not heaven. We're not there yet. Number two, we must recognize that God is in control. We don't have all the answers. But we must trust Him. His ways, I read this week in my quiet time, His ways are not our ways. We don't always understand. But we can trust Him. Daniel said in chapter 4, verse 35 and 37, well, Nebuchadnezzar says, "No one can hold back his hand to Him, to God, and say, 'What have you done?'" I mean, you can do that, but really, can you? Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and exalt and glorify the King of Heaven, because everything He does is right, and all His ways are just. So, establish that when you're thrown a curve in life, or tribulation, another word, where you're probably more familiar with. You need to understand that everything God does is right. He loves us. He's got a purpose in it. Again, we don't always understand. 2 Corinthians, I do understand this to a certain extent. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9, it says, this happened that we might rely not on ourselves, on God. So there's real purpose. There's other reasons for a curve. That's one of them. It throws us our dependence upon Him. I trust that's what you do. And then number three, we must recognize the importance of knowing Him. Isaiah 30, verse 22, it says, "Although the Lord gives you the bread of adversity and the waters of affliction, your teachers will be hidden no more. Turn to God, get Him His word, spend time with Him, get the How do we respond when life throws us a curve? We'll go a long ways in determining the quality of our life. Reaction, challenge, that's a good challenge. And we're all going to face it sooner or later. Some of you already have, and are right now, or you will in the future. So be prepared for that. How do you react? Now, the second great reaction challenge is may not be quite so obvious, but it can defeat you. And that's what I call ruinous reactions. Ruinous reactions. We read this morning in Scripture, Mark 7, verse 20. What comes out of a person is what defiles it. For from within, out of man's heart, comes evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these things come from within to make a person unclean. So again, our topic, the second reaction that we're talking about is revealing or ruinous reactions. Now, I was raised in a Christian home, so at a very early age I was taught the do's and don'ts. Didn't always understand it, didn't always get a real good explanation, but I understood what they were and I was told what they were. And clearly, wrong actions are going to harm us. And we can understand that. We don't always understand it when we're young, but as we get older, we see that. But there was a need for some proper actions to be sure. But I think what we don't understand sometimes is that we can be just as ruined by wrong reactions to the actions or reactions of others. And so that's what I wanted to address this morning. We need to realize that wrong reactions can hurt us as much as wrong actions. The action of somebody else, you could be innocent. The action of someone else, you have a wrong reaction, and it can defeat your life. And the enemy's well aware of that, and he's going to take advantage of that. Wrong reactions can be found in people whose actions on the surface are correct. A person may not lie, may not cheat, may not swear, may not get drunk, may not commit adultery, yet you don't really know that person. They may be defeated because of the way they reacted to others, the actions of others. We're a person to watch us. They don't really know us. Of course, God knows us. It is our reactions, our spontaneous, unconscious reactions that reveal what we really are. My wife and I, years ago, I was thinking about this earlier this morning. It had to be, I think in 19, what had to be, 71, I think that's when my daughter was born. My wife always did one of those cards out. 71 or 72, whatever. Remember, I had 6, that's a lot. Now I got 19 grandchildren along the way. If it wasn't for a calendar, I'd really be lost. I remember this. We volunteered to watch a nursery attending Calvary Baptist Tabernacle Festival in New York. And so we volunteered. And I have not had much of that opportunity. I think I only remember doing the nursery once. But I remember in that. Kids are also cute coming in, you know, you hand your child, it's so lovely, you know, beautiful. And then, you know what I noticed, and they have a really nice first class nursery, a lot of toys, a ton of kids. And I'm telling you what happened, they all had this habit, the one toy. Or you take a child, we got that 2 Sundays ago, with children, you know, right? And I saw a couple of them this morning. And put them in playpen. Oh, they're so lovely. You know? And then you put another child in with them. And you see some reactions, but you see some things happen. That's the way it is. It's not so much our actions that reveal what we are, but that's our unplanned reactions. So I want to give you 4 basic factors to consider concerning our reactions. Write these down, it'd be good to have these. But 4 basic factors to consider concerning our reactions. Factor number 1 is this: consider who are the adversaries. Consider who are the adversaries. First of all, we need to know, and you know this, in a non-Christian world, we're going to be treated in non-Christian actions and ways, right? You know that. We're prepared for that. And 1 John 3:13, it says, "Do not be surprised, my brothers, if the world hates you." John 15:18 says, Jesus says this, "If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first." And so we understand that, and we have to learn to deal with that. Christians can be unkind. I'm not saying, I think I read this. Can be unkind, unethical, critical, dishonest, quarrelsome. That's not what we want to find in others, but that's what we often find in others. And how do we react to that? Now, I remember specifically years ago, actually the first day of my life, this is my 39th, this is back in the late 70s, and there was something going on at the church, and I wanted to deal with it, and so I was going to deal with it the way you shouldn't do. It had been a huge mistake, but from the pulpit, you see, I saw some happenings, and so I reacted. Thank God, I came across some of this material many during that time. I thought, oh, my goodness, actually, they're calling me. I'm going to go up there and say something publicly for everybody. That's not a good thing. It's interesting. I was preparing something on reactions, and God was having me prepare it, not so much for the audience, for me, because I was actually being controlled by the actions of some of our people in the church. And I thought, I'm going to get them. What better place to get them is from the pulpit? That's what I thought. Again, that would have been a huge mistake. You see, their actions were controlling me. So I was going to find a way to get after them. But what I found interesting is that God was speaking to me, gave me some of this material. Really, Dan, this is exactly what you're doing. Preaching brothers, you need this because this is what you're doing. Galatians 5:15 says that if we bite and devour one another, we bite and devour one another. It says, take heed that ye be not consumed of one another. This I say, then walk in the spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So number one, we need to consider that we are the adversaries, unsaved world, and the world in which we live. We're going to often be mistreated, and we're seeing increases in that area. Ridicule today. But I think I struggle greater when it's another Christian. And my guess is so do you. You say, well, I kind of expect that. That's not a person, not a Christian. That person's a Christian. I didn't expect that. And wow, but you know, we're capable of that behavior ourselves, too. So we need to understand that. Number two, you need to consider who's in control. You need to consider who's in control. We realize that our reactions reveal who really is in control. Is it really the Holy Spirit? Who's in control? Jeremiah 17:9 says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. And reactions reveal what's going on inside of us. If I had a cup of hot water up here and a tea bag, and I put tea in the hot water, the water becomes usually brown, right? Now, the hot water didn't put that brown in the tea bag. What did it do? It merely brought the brown out of what was already in the tea bag. That's what I understand, right? Did I do that right? I got that right? But how do we react when we're in hot water? And we're often in hot water, aren't we? Other people. But how do we react is the question. What dominates us at that moment? In this word defile, that which comes out of the man, that's what defiles, to make foul, dirty, to pollute. Now we stop to think about this, stay with me. That is why we cannot blame the pressure built up by a problem for the way we react. We can never honestly blame the difficulty for the wrong things we say or do. God says, again, yes, keep that in mind. God says that the situation does not put these sins into us, it merely brings out what we already were, what was already there, brings it out. God shows me by my reactions that I have a very critical person, and I admit it to him, and begin to deal with it, then I go spiritually. Yep. Now, if we react the same manner that other person acts toward us, they control us. Reactions will destroy us. Someone flares up, so we flare up in return. Someone criticizes us, so we criticize them. You ever been in a store, and they have these little, like, candies, little things that little children see and run through the aisle. And I've seen this more than once. It's never happened to me, but I've seen it others. But the child wants something. And let's pick on the dads. And the dads, they get that. And so what happens? The kid stomps his feet a little bit louder. So what happens? You see this, and then the dad gets a little stronger, and they go back and forth. Free, you know what? The kid's controlling the father, the mother, whatever. Now I was trying to think about this this morning. But like, let me come up with that real good way to tell you, but I'm with a lot of grandchildren. I love them. Love this one time. And I don't really have enough that kind of problem. Seriously. But I'm thinking, I gotta be fair about this. It's gotta be some different things. First of all, they're not with me 24/7, not with them 24/7. And then they figure they know they're gonna get something anyway, so. So the first thing I think, not Danny, of course, but the other ones. You know? And then I thought, you know, no, maybe I'm not that great. Because they know they're going to get something. You know? But I think I'm not doing it. But again, you can tell who's in charge, who's in control. Now, as Christians, we're being controlled by the Spirit, not by others, not by circumstances. I want to address this business of being controlled by others. Taking down this verse. The Word of God has much to say about this. In Romans 12:17, it says, do not repay anyone evil for evil. Never pay back evil for evil. 1 Thessalonians 5:15, make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong. See that no one repays another but evil for evil. Remember, this is God speaking. 1 Peter 3:9, do not repay evil for evil or insult for insult, but with blessing. This you were called so that you may inherit a blessing. Now, I didn't really dissect that verse, but to do that, I'm going to there's something in that about the blessing part. Okay? We repeat that. Do not repay evil for evil or insult for insult, but with blessing, because to this you were called so that you may inherit a blessing. For whosoever would love life and see good days, whoever would love life and see good days must keep his tongue from evil and his lips from deceitful speech. And his lips from deceitful speech. Proverbs 24:29 says, do not say, I'll do to him what he's done to me. You ever say, God, why did you say that? I like that. But God says, don't do that. Do not say, I'll do to him as he's done to me. The temptation can be great sometimes. The outcome. God wants more that you really want. Then Proverbs 20, verse 22, do not say, I will pay you back for this wrong. Wait for the Lord, and he will deliver you. And there's where comes trust. Sometimes the action of someone else is very hurtful, very harmful. But God's going to take care of that. God will take care of that. Police passages say the same thing. They tell us not to react the same way people act toward us if their actions and reactions were improper. If they had sinful actions or sinful reactions, God says not to be guilty of reaction in an evil manner. So number one, you need to consider who's in, number one, who's the adversaries. We're the adversaries. Remember, it's the world, the Christian. In other words, the saved and the unsaved. Who's in control? Number three, factor number three is this, consider who will be hurt. Consider who will be hurt. Nothing actually is going to, I was thinking about this as I'm preparing this and studying it. Something pretty deep here. Very familiar verse, Romans 8:28. We know that all things work together for good to them who love God, to them are all according to his purpose. We all know that verse, right? Woe to be really. How's God going to? Somebody, is that nasty? Is that critical? Whatever. it out. Work it out. This means, here's the deep part. This means that it makes no difference what happens if we really believe that everything God allows in our lives is working for our, I don't tend to understand all that. We trust that it's God's word, that God said it. And we need to believe that. In that case, whatever happens makes a contribution to our spiritual growth. Get that? This is a challenge. So important we get this. There is a sense, and again, you don't see this as deep, but I do. There is a sense in which we have no enemies. A situation, a problem, circumstance. There's no circumstance, are we not? A difficulty is not an enemy. All these things work for what God said. For those who love Him, called according to His purpose. The reaction to what happens is not right, then of course our reactions will hurt us. There's a situation, the situation that God allows does not hurt us, instead it will help if our reactions to it are mature and spiritual properly. There were some good examples. Helen Keller, she was hurt because she was blind. Beethoven was deaf. Thomas Edison had only 3 months of school. In the Bible, you think John the Apostle was hurt because he was exiled to the island of Patmos? No, because he came back with the book of Revelation. God has a purpose. If our reactions are wrong, we react with resentment, that resentment will ruin us. We react with bitterness, that bitterness will blight us. If we react with anger and hatred, they may result in bodily ills. Bodily ills. Ulcers. Others can control us. If we don't react in a Christ-like way, we're going to pay a price. Number four. This is the last one. Consider who's responsible for our reactions. Well, you know who's responsible, right? Tendency to say the other person's actions were so wrong that we cannot be blamed for our reactions. Have you been there? You've been there. I know you have. You've been there more than once. Sometimes you're getting handled on some of these things. Other times, it seems like the devil can hold somebody or however it works. I don't know how it works, but they can say some really unkind things. Hurtful things. Sometimes intentionally, sometimes not intentionally. Sometimes, if we're not careful, we can misread. I learned a lot of that with my wife's illness, where people say things. First, man, I wasn't reacting too well, and I thought, I had to learn how they really don't mean harm. You know, that the adversary, he knows your weaknesses, he knows where you're going through difficult times. He try to get in there, get an edge in there. They're Christians, look what they're saying. You know, be so careful. Wait a minute, just how to handle that. Must be admitted that others are guilty of wrong actions, to be sure, but the Bible says we are responsible for our wrong reactions. Again, 1 Thessalonians 5:13, see that no one renders evil for evil. And in that word, see, is the key. Take it upon yourself. It's your responsibility. It's my responsibility. See to it that I take responsibility. For those of us who are Christians, we have the Spirit of God living within us. He guides us. He teaches us. He instructs us. He's faithful. Far more faithful than we are. Nonetheless, he remains faithful. He'll tell you. You know. You might get so angry at first, and you might blow it, and it might take a little while. We need to get to the point. I wasn't going to use my wife as an illustration, but when you first got to home, people were saying things, and kind of quick. Judge that. And then I had to learn, no, it's not really what they meant. Or they didn't say anything because they didn't know what to say. And then I began to get a handle on it. And now, it's not a big deal. See, God quickly convicted me. He did. And he did not react to it. This is a very hurtful area, and that's where the enemy seems to make his inroads. He knows where you're weak. He knows where you're hurt. actions of others may have been wrong. None of us are responsible. Or don't let that them control you. You know, I thought about this often. It's a shame that the sin of another can cause you to sin. The sin of another, you could be innocent in a situation. Guiltless. You're mistreated. And you don't allow the Spirit of God, if you're a Christian, he's going to tell you right away, hey, what your attitude's not right here. Then you've got to deal with it. If you don't, then how about us make that quite good? You're right now, you're pretty good spiritually. This person is Christian, but they're not. They said some really nasty, critical things. They did something. They're down here. Respond to that, and you respond to bitterness and anger, pulled you down here. You can feel better. In fact, it's going to hurt you. It's going to hurt you. We want the other person to take responsibility for their actions. We must take responsibility. Now, how do we do this? Quickly, in closing, how do we do this? First of all, we must admit God has been showing us. I don't know how he speaks. If he's speaking to you about this, I don't know your relationships with people. I don't know your encounters, even just this last week. I mean, these kind of experiences can happen almost on a daily basis at the workplace, or, you know, where there's more than one person. It can happen. And we need to admit that what we have seen is God showing us. We must immediately admit that we have been critical, no matter what someone else may have said or done to us. The thing we need to do is admit our wrong action. We must ask the Holy Spirit to make the matter so real to us. Do you know what? He will do that. He's faithful. Sometimes I wasn't even aware of it. It quickly pricks your spirit. He makes you aware of it. And then what you need to do is admit it. We must admit it. Number two, we must refuse to defend ourselves. We must refuse to defend ourselves. And or this time, ask forgiveness the number of times that I'm just not going to do it anymore. And what happens is you don't forgive, or you don't react improperly. And again, you were here, now you're here. If you don't want to be here, you're in trouble. It's not what God intended you to be. And he will enable you to back up here. That makes sense. Illustrating it. You admit it, but don't make excuses. And then finally, you must fully confess our wrong. Confess it. This is not always easy. Sometimes you're going to rest. I try to make this easy, understand, but it's not always easy. And there's going to be times you are going to wrestle for a little while. But still very careful. Remember, we looked at this principle last week, don't let the sun go down on it. Don't put a bet on it. Whatever. You need to deal with it. I understand there can be some pretty hurtful things sometimes, but it's the reaction that's going to hurt you, not what that person said or did. If we believe Romans 8:28. Lord, I confess the sin of wrongful reaction and offenses. So, four basic factors to consider concerning our reactions. Consider who are the adversaries, and they are who? World, Christian. And for us that are Christians, more often than not, a Christian, she's a Christian. Why would they do that, right? And careful. Consider who's in control. You may think you're in control, but you'll know who's in control because the Spirit of God will tell you you're not. Aren't you thankful for his faithfulness to us? Consider who will be hurt. Consider who is responsible. So the two great reaction challenges, as I said, are when life throws us a curve. How do we react? How do we react? Now, I'm so thankful again. I don't want to make this so simple that forget it is, but it can be a struggle at times. When that curve hits you, it's going to take some time, and that's okay. God's not going to withhold his love for you. He knows how weak we are. We're told in the Psalm 104, 103, verse 14, to James 3:2, he says, we all stumble. He knows. He's understand that, we'll be dead. Be honest about this. Who is really in control? It's things like this that save marriages. It's this kind of principle that save relationships with our kids. It's these principles that save relationships in the workplace. So the adversaries whose control will be hurt. And again, can't overemphasize this. The shame to be hurt. And get defeated. The wrong actions of somebody else. The enemy is well aware of that. He knows where he can get you. Greater who's he is. He's in us than he's in the world. We've experienced that. And then consider who's responsible. We are. Amen? Challenges that we all face. And thank you that we have the Holy Spirit, the Word of God that equip us, does equip us, does enable us to live happy and productive lives. And to that end, I pray. Father, I thank you for the people here. If you didn't know them, good people, good church. Enjoy them. Just coming in this morning, just the greetings, the smiles, seeing the children, the middle age, the older people, it's an evening. And Lord, most important, and we thank you also for that worship music. Gets us prepared for the service. And Father, as we